Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the State of the City Address for 2021. We ask that you please rise for the presentation of colors by the City of Miramar Police Department Honor Guard and the Pledge of Allegiance led by Cub Scout Pack 441. We welcome Mayor Wayne M. Messam.
Lead up, got me thinking, babe. Tell me if you with it, cause I'm with it, babe. I haven't heard from you and I'm in it, babe. Just tell me what to do and I get it, babe. Gucci and Prada. Trip deep crib in the middle of the night. I don't let you miss me as I put it down right, babe. I can put you on a flight. You know that it like me can change your life, oh, babe.
It's okay to dance. Turn it back up, DJ. It's okay. Let's go. It's all right. All right. Yes. Good evening, everyone. How are we doing this evening? No, we can do better than that. Miramar, good evening. How are we doing today? All right. So I heard our assistant city manager, Gail, recognize our visitors and our distinguished guests. And first of all, on her list was to recognize, you know, our commissioners, our elected officials, and special dignitaries. And I saw on there a particular person to be introduced, and I said, no, I have to do that introduction. And I would like to recognize my partner in life, my bride, Angela Messam, and my family. And I have my son, Wayne, Kayla, who's one of the twins. The twin son is on campus right now. And my niece, Nisha. So I wanted to recognize my family first before I did anything. And also, I'll take this personal privilege to also say thank you to my dear friend, Letitia Hall, retired veteran and community leader, Letitia Hall, who actually filled in the gap for a very special matriarch of our city who passed away this year, Miss Norma Martin, who every year would prepare for me a lunch before my State of the City. And this is the first address with her being deceased. And Letitia texted me early this morning and asked, she knew that Miss Norma would prepare for me a lunch, so she said, would I like for her to get something for lunch in her memory? And I'd like to thank you, Letitia, for that thoughtful gesture. And I'm still full. Well, for the moment of the day, I would like to present the State of the City on behalf of the Miramar City Commission. You had an opportunity to hear from my colleagues on the commission and their priorities and their initiatives. We do this together. I'm the mayor of the city that you all have blessed me to have that honor to represent this city as the mayor. And I work alongside my colleagues on the commission with our city administration to ensure that the city of Miramar upholds its duty to make sure that you have the quality community that you have invested in and that your businesses have invested in and that we all call home. And I'm just so ecstatic to stand here in the middle of this stage to declare that despite the pandemic, despite the loss of life, despite the economic interruption, that the city of Miramar is doing very well, and the prospects of our future is not only strong, but is certain. And I'd like to thank everyone, our city staff, the Miramar City Commission, and you, our community, because without you and us working together, we would not be able to give the report that you'll hear this evening. So give yourselves a round of applause. So what can you expect this evening? This evening has been organized to cover three areas. First, we'd like to cover some of the accomplishments of the city, not every accomplishment, but some highlights, as well as take a minute to pause to reflect on the impact of the pandemic and what it did to our city and how we had to respond and the way the city provided resources during this difficult time. And then we'll have an opportunity to explore and imagine what the city of Miramar can and should be. So first, in terms of our accomplishments, we'll take a look at our business climate. We all know that our corporate existence, our corporate health is very important. Whether you're an entrepreneur or if you're an employee or employer, we have to pay the bills. We need resources to be able to do the things that we want to do in life. So let's take a look. So when the pandemic rocked us to the core, there were so many uncertainties. Some of us asked, how will I pay my bills? Because your business was shut down. Are we safe? Will a vaccine be available to address this virus and this pandemic? And in some cases, even in our own homes, we have lost family members. We know in our city of Miramar family and our employees, we've lost our closest friends and colleagues to this pandemic. What if I can't pay my mortgage? What will the federal government do? What will their response be in terms of addressing this pandemic? These were all the questions that we faced when the pandemic was actually defined as a pandemic and what we would do. And then that very critical question, will our economy suffer? Because if we are on lockdown, we cannot go to work, we cannot open our businesses, we can't generate revenue. So what will we do as a city and a community? And as a city in which we depend not only on your property values, we had your property taxes on lock. We were gonna get that anyway, right? But a significant portion of our budget is dependent on our shared revenue with county and state revenue sources, taxes that we collect, and we knew that that would be impacted. So let's take a look on how we fared economically. What was very interesting that we discovered during the pandemic and looking back, when we had all these fears about how businesses would be impacted, we actually noticed two things. One, businesses did okay. Many businesses took the opportunity during this chaos to actually expand. And some of these businesses, over the next couple of slides, you'll recognize some of these icons. They actually expanded. JL Audio, which has been in the city for nearly 40 years, decided to expand because they saw the prospects of expansion taking place. Amarant, NFI, Nutrition Formulators, Chimera Exomes, all of these businesses. Some of these brands you may recognize in terms of Starbucks and Publix. You know, when we saw that Publix was actually moving to the corner of Miramar Parkway and Flamingo, we're like, wait a minute, there's already a Publix in Monarch Lakes and one right here on Palm. So we're gonna put another Publix, just a mile away. So now we have three Publixes between 145th and Palm Avenue. Well, corporations like that don't decide to make those type of decisions on a whim. They have indicators that state that the future is bright, and we have to respond to development that they are seeing that's taking place in Miramar. So the first point that we learned was that businesses expanded. But what really rocked us and got us jumping up was that not only did businesses expand, we actually had businesses move and come to Miramar. These are just some of the brands that you will see. Some are recognizable, but what I really like about it, that not only large companies came, but mom and pop companies came. When developers took the risk to develop the large tracts of land on Flamingo and Miramar Parkway, they had retail space that had to be occupied with additional vendors beyond the traditional anchors like your Publix's and your Ross's. You have your mom and pops that occupy those 1,200 and 1,500 square feet bays in these establishments. And they took the risk during the pandemic. And they could choose any city in South Florida. But guess who they chose? Miramar to come to. This next slide shows other major corporations that decided to come and expand. You know, a lot of attention is on the development, and you'll hear more about at Flamingo and Miramar Parkway. But of note, many of you heard in the news that Amazon decided to put one of their distribution sites right just south of Miramar Parkway at the Kohl's, just south of the Kohl's Shopping Center. And what's so amazing about Amazon is that when you look at these companies, do you know that you can go on Amazon right now and you can order something at 10 a.m. and it'll be at your doorstep by 4 p.m.? How do you think I have this tie on today, right? So that's just amazing when you think about the innovation that's taking place. UTI, Universal Technical Institute, is a company that trains individuals in technical skills like mechanics and aviation and automotive. These are skills that are lacking because of the advancement in technology. Combustion engines are now converting to electric cars, and someone has to fix them, right? So we have to ensure that we're treating and training the workforce to be able to be a part of that supply chain and that maintenance chain, to ensure that as technology grows and we indulge in these new technologies, that we have people to actually repair them. So we're really excited about this expansion in the city of Miramar. Now, this is just an overview of the development that's taking place on Red Road and Flamingo, at the core of the city. These are the last available large tracts of land. And as you can see with this aerial, all of the developments that are being built and coming out of the ground, some have already opened, and they're here in the city of Miramar for us to be able to expand our options, whether it's retail, whether it's business and entrepreneurial expansion. It's here in Miramar. I challenge if you will see in any other city in South Florida the amount of activity and energy than right here in Miramar. A couple of it highlights, some of the business spotlights. We talked about the Publix that, and if you haven't been to the new Publix off of Flamingo and Miramar Parkway, it's their new concept. They actually have a restaurant seating area. They've really transformed shopping for just everyday goods. And it's a treat to be able to go there. Sometimes I will pass two or three Publixes just to go to that one to experience that new build out that they have. And we have one of the newest concepts in retail grocery shopping right here in the city of Miramar. The Grove, right off of Miramar Boulevard and Flamingo, is a boutique development that has an animal veterinary hospital, learning experience, what I really get excited about because it's teaching and investing in our little leaders that are growing up and giving them the foundation that they're going to need to be scholars and our future leaders. Miramar Station, which is right across on the east side of Flamingo and Miramar Parkway, where there will be 648 multifamily units, some retail space, and all these shopping centers. It's very competitive in the supermarket industry, as you can see. And one of our favorites, Chick-fil-A, you know. Now, we've been having some challenges with the Chick-fil-A on Dyke, right, because of the queue. I don't know what they put in that chicken, but people are willing to be stacked 50 cars deep through a drive-thru. But we took that experience, our planning department, and ensured that this location had double drive-through lanes and some engineering considerations to make that experience a lot less impactful to the community. So we're looking forward to additional Chick-fil-A. Maybe we don't have to wait as long as the one that's already up and running. And at the heart and gateway of our community, just steps away from this location, we have the Altus Ultra, where it's at the northwest intersection of Miramar Parkway, where there is a tremendous retail development and luxury apartments that's being built before. And some of those occupants you'll see who are there, like Starbucks, and it's already open, so they're not fully completed, but go ahead and let's support those businesses that are there. And here's just some of the vendors that will be at the retail portion of it. Flanagan's, which is like your everyday barbecue spot where you can go watch games. The Boy Scouts will probably enjoy that, right? So thank you all for being here tonight. And we have AT&T, Starbucks, and some other mom-and-pop establishments, and that's what I like to see. And at Town Center, right across from City Hall, Block 2, Related Group, which is one of the nation's premier developers, took an interest in Miramar. And we sold that Block 2, which is the final block for Town Center to be developed. And this establishment that you'll hear about in a minute is located right across from City Hall, and it will offer some of the most luxurious housing accommodations for anyone. And the great thing about that is that they partnered with us to address some affordable housing challenges we're facing, and you'll hear about that in a minute. Now, in terms of development, we have really grown in the city of Miramar as it relates to hotels. I know sometimes in our city we just think about our immediate family and our homes and what we can benefit from, but we now have nearly 1,100 hotel rooms in the city of Miramar. So we're not just only able to service the community and our local businesses, but we are a player in the region. And we work with the Convention and Visitors Bureau of Broward County, also known as sunny.org, to attract individuals to our community to lodge in our hotels. When there's a major event, a sporting event or entertainment event at Hard Rock, those visitors stay in Miramar. They don't even go to the much more expensive Guitar Hotel on State Road 7. They stay here in Miramar. Why is that important? Well, our same small businesses, our restaurants, and other establishments, they get an uptick in business when these events take place, and we don't necessarily think about that. Now, the city of Miramar doesn't necessarily collect on bed tax when lodgers stay at these hotels. However, when a city has 1,100 keys or hotel rooms in their city, we now can leverage our ability to network and compel Broward County to invest in the city of Miramar because of the millions of dollars in taxes that is generated right here from our city. And I will say and will commend Broward County for partnering with the city. We've been the recipient of many grants as it relates to cultural arts and entertainment because of the number of hotels that we have. And we are standing right here, as you can see on the screen, at the brand new Suncoast Credit Union, which is the third largest credit union in the state. I left them out of the expansion. They decided to expand. They were in Huntington. They decided to come here when they could have gone anywhere else. Their headquarters is literally in the Space Coast, which is in Melbourne County. But they invested here in Broward County, and more specifically in our city. And I know a lot of our talk has been in central Miramar, but the activity is very hot in historic Miramar. The original home, our bedrock community, East Miramar, that is where it started, 1955. There are significant developments and changes that are taking place in the city of Miramar, and we're happy to see that there are many commercial rehabilitation projects that are taking place to expand and improve the shopping or the business experience for our residents in historic Miramar. Now, at this time, we had a very candid conversation with some of our businesses in the community, large and small, to talk about why they decided to expand in Miramar, what they like about Miramar, what we can do better as a community and as a city. So take a look at the video.
Hi, I'm Leah Carpenter. I'm the Executive Vice President and Chief Operating Officer for the Memorial Healthcare System. We have been here since 2005. We continue to grow and expand. We did just open up our primary care facility here. It's an awesome place for you to receive your care, and I think that we will be here long, well after I'm retired, and certainly well into the future.
I'm Rebecca Byam. I'm the Chief Financial Officer of HCW Biologics. We are a company created to make treatments for age-related diseases. So as HCW Biologics, we have a company joke that it stands for Heaven Can Wait.
My name is Teodoro Teixeira. I'm president of the company On Nutrition USA, but we converted it now to a company called Duro Body Sports. It's about nutrition and fitness. I envision my company, Miramar, much bigger, more stable.
We receive visitors from all over the world, bankers, investors, collaborators, corporate partners. So it's ideal that we're located in a place where people have easy access to us from both Fort Lauderdale and Miami airports. We would like to expand our business, and we'd like to do it here in Miramar.
So I think the city of Miramar keeps us safe and has been since we opened the doors. I think what's most important is that we continue to partner in day-to-day operations. You're present in our emergency room, you're present on our campuses.
Miramar is a safe location to have a business and to live here. So I see myself in this community for a very, very, very long time.
I think, quite honestly, relevance for the city of Miramar, for the Memorial Healthcare System, or any industry for that matter, really is about listening to what our community needs, what our community wants.
For any city to grow, and we know that small business is the backbone of America, and especially South Florida, if a city does not help to coach or mentor a business, how do you expect that business to go on to the next level? And that's one beautiful thing that the city of Miramar offers.
We appreciate that the city of Miramar is committed to improving the quality of life for both its residents and the businesses here. We're thrilled with the growth and glad to be part of it, but we'd appreciate it if traffic conditions could be taken into consideration.
The city of Miramar is well prepared with that Department of Business Development. And I think that the city needs to advertise that to the small businesses.
It's really more about listening and less about talking. I think if you continue to listen the way you have been as a mayor, as our commissioners always do, I think you're gonna meet the needs for a long, long time to come.
I consider Miramar my home, a great place to run a business, and a great place to raise your family.
You know, and as a small business owner myself, I can resonate with a lot of what is said, and I'm sure you in the audience can resonate with a lot of the things that were said. You know, it's always good to hear the great things that you're doing as a community, but it's always, you know, it's sobering when you really get out into the community and speak to our stakeholders to learn on how we can improve better. And it's a consistent theme as we're trying. With our growth, we must manage our traffic, right? And it talks about the city of Miramar having so many resources for small businesses. So it's telling us in that interview that we have to do, even though we're doing so much and impacting so many small businesses, there are even more small businesses who aren't even aware of the resources that are available to them. So we'll continue to be challenged. And when we are challenged, we can rise to the occasion to meet the needs of our deserving community. So next, let's talk about some of our economic development data. This is just one slide, so you don't have to worry about some long dissertation, but I want to bring to life what some of these bullets mean. And during the pandemic, we had double-digit unemployment. Not just in the city of Miramar, but in Broward County and in the state and nationally. It really rocked us to the core. But we're pleased to see that our economy has bounced back, and in the city of Miramar, our unemployment rate is 5.5%, which means that most, practically almost every resident that wants to work has a job. An indicator of our expansion and development is how many permits we are pulling at our building department. And as you can see, during the pandemic, we served in over 55,000 permits during the pandemic. Currently, right now, we've issued over 17,000 building permits with construction value nearly $500 million that's coming out of the ground in the city of Miramar. So sometimes we get caught up in the little nuances on what's not right or working in our city, but when we look at the 30,000-foot view, we have something special here, and it's not by accident. For our property owners here, you see that your property values are going up. We may not necessarily like the associated increase in property taxes that comes with that, but our commission, we really work hard to challenge staff to present a budget that doesn't impact that millage rate, and they'll tell you that. So we try to be very cognizant of that. So we are really doing well despite the challenges of the pandemic. So let's look at some of the improvements we've done in the city to enhance the quality of life for our residents. The city of Miramar and our capital improvement plan, we have so many projects. And some of note is the East Water Treatment Plant in historic Miramar. It is a state-of-the-art treatment facility that is providing some of the purest water for our residents when we renovated that project, that asset to our city. We are continually improving our streets and our drainage. We've opened up a new public safety facility in the east, and we've invested over $160 million in East Miramar in infrastructure, which will definitely improve the quality of life, and you'll hear a little bit about that in a moment. As you all know, every 10 years in the United States, we count our population. And we'd like to thank you for your response for those who participated. In the city of Miramar, we had a 72% response rate compared to 63% in the state. So let me ask you a question. In terms of what is the city's population per the per the 2020 census count? Anyone, shout it out. What do you think? How large is our city? How many people live here in the city of Miramar? 150, okay. What else? 168? 200,000? Yeah, we may get there one day. We may get there one day. But actually, our population, according to the census, is 134,000. That's just who we counted. There are a lot of people that didn't get counted. Remember, our response rate was 72. But our first response is more reflective of where we probably are as a city. We're hovering around 150,000, which just 15 years ago, we were 90. Contemplate that on how fast we've grown as a city. The median age is 34, which means we have a lot of young families. The median household income in the city of Miramar is actually 73,000 when you encompass the entire city. We are a marketer's dream. Young families who make money. Now, we do have some zip codes, and you look at those zip codes that may average around mid-30s for the average median income. But as a whole, our city does pretty well, and we're continuing to make sure that all ships rise in our city. And the average household value is about $340,000. Another note that we were very pleased to find out in the city of Miramar, that Smart Asset did a nationwide economic well-being national survey as it relates to Hispanic Americans and African Americans. And African Americans in the city of Miramar fare well very well in the city of Miramar. We rank number 5 in the entire nation. So if you're black in the city of Miramar, the city of Miramar is in 5th in the nation as it relates to your well-being. If you're Hispanic, we rank first, number 1, in terms of your economic well-being. And this survey can be found at smartasset.com, and we'll provide that link so you can read the study to see the basis of design of the study and what are all the factors that they looked at to determine what does it mean in terms of your economic well-being. Meaning that if you have a job, how much do you make, and your mobility, your economic mobility in the community. And that is something that we all can be proud of, especially because Miramar is a majority black and brown community. So that's something that we have to not only celebrate, but ensure that we maintain and that we grow. We talked about some of the multifamily developments, the best and luxurious Class A offerings that we have. For example, this development here that shows 280 apartments right off the intersection of Flamingo and the Turnpike. And we actually had to take a step back because it's a double-edged sword. Because we've been a city that has attracted so much development, so much luxury apartments. Most individuals probably can't afford the rent that you have to pay. And you'll see some of those rents on the next slide. But we were rocked to our core when there was a Sun Sentinel article that said that the city of Miramar was the second least affordable city in all of Florida. I said, that cannot be true. How could we be more expensive than Fisher Island, right? Right? But when you really look at the data, the city of Miramar, we don't have any HUD housing. We don't have any affordable housing projects to offset those rents that take place, for example, in Fort Lauderdale in Miami. There's a bedroom community that expanded, and that expansion was market rate developments that you're seeing going up right now. So although we've been blessed to attract some of the best developers and some of the best housing Class A products to offer quality Class A housing, we also realize that everyday blue-collar workers who may not necessarily have the employment to afford these rents, it's very hard for them to find a place to live. I mean, look at your own homes and say, wow, our house is now worth $200,000 more than when we bought it. But if you sell it, where are you going to move to? Right? Right? So think about that teacher. Think about that rookie police officer or fire rescue personnel who loves the city that they work in but can't afford to live in the city that they protect and serve. So the city commission and our city staff, we've been at work. We have not rested on our laurels. Here are some of the examples of some of the rents. Uris Apartments, rent range, $2,300 to $4,900. Can you imagine that? A $5,000 apartment in the city of Miramar? Imagine that. But that's reality here. And people are paying it. And people can afford it. But not everyone. I'm just pausing just for us for that to sink in. So in our progress, we're excited about it, but we have to understand that a well-run city, a quality community, ensures that there is housing for all of our residents. So we've been intentional about what we've done with the powers and the controls that we have. Currently, right now, we're developing over 300 deed-restricted affordable developments. We've established an affordable housing advisory committee. We've secured an affordable housing trust fund where we are working with developers to fund. So if you're going to come in our city and take advantage of our nice demographics, well-off families, to be able to rent in your rental developments, we're asking you to help us solve this challenge by either making some of your units available for affordable housing or contribute to our affordable housing trust so that we can have resources available to ensure that we have the units for residents who can't afford to pay $5,000 a month for an apartment. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. We want to be able to offer that, and we want to be a city to be able to attract businesses that can pay their employees. And one of our benefits is that we have this diversity of housing stock of lavish life, modest life, because employers see the city of Miramar having a diversity of housing stock means that not only that they can have housing for their workers close to their business establishment, but their executives can live in the city, their middle management can live in the city, as well as their lower level employees can live close to the place where they work. A couple of highlights on some affordable housing developments. Najiba Gardens, if you recall on last year's State of the City, which was virtual, and it's so good to see each of you today in person, because last year it was on a stage with an empty auditorium, speaking into a camera and hoping that you are listening to the presentation, but now I know I have you captive and you're paying attention. But we talked about Najiba Gardens, which is in historic Miramar. Very successful development. It was 30 apartment units, and it was so successful that the developer was able to acquire a lot across the street, and they are breaking ground on phase two, and that's located on 64th Avenue, and we're really excited about their success. Not just for the developer. We want the developer to profit and do well, but I'm more concerned, and I'm sure my colleagues on the commission are, and our city staff are concerned, about those 30 families that will call those units home. We recently broke ground on a public-private partnership with the city of Miramar and the Archdiocese of Miami, who received funding from the Florida Housing Finance Corporation for the Casa Sant'Angelo development, which will present 113 senior affordable units. So if you think about the working family not being able to afford housing in Miramar, what about our seniors? And let's give a round of applause to our seniors that are here from our senior crowd. They partake in our programs and our services and our facilities, and it's heartbreaking when you have a conversation with one of them and they say, "Mayor, I had to leave out of my apartment because the landlord increased the rent. I have a fixed income with Social Security, a small pension, and I no longer can live in the city that I love." And a development like Casa Sant'Angelo will present 113 affordable housing units, quality Class A units, right across from Regional Park, just moments away from I-75 and public transportation and shopping for our seniors. And we're really excited about that. But we doubled down, and not just that senior affordable housing project. We have another public-private partnership with the developer to deliver another 117 senior affordable housing units at the location of the old Miramar Police Headquarters. How many of you remember where that location is? Right off of Douglas and Miramar Parkway. We demolished that facility, and it's right next door to our adult daycare center in the city of Miramar. They'll have a fitness room, cyber cafe, a library, very active lifestyles. So I'm sure our seniors are really anxious to see how they can sign up to be one of those tenants. Now, as you all know, the city of Miramar, you know, we love to throw a good party and have a lot of activities in the city of Miramar. And, you know, some of our colleagues around South Florida, our peers around South Florida say, "Wow, the city of Miramar, you all do so much." But if you really think about it, it really does enhance the quality of life for our community. We do our best to do an active and diverse offering of community events for children, for adults. If you're Black, Jamaican, Haitian, Hispanic, regardless, We try to do our best to offer activities for our community so that our community can have fun. These are the memories that our kids remember going to carnivals, remember going to festivals, remember going to concerts. Who would have thought just 10 years ago that we would have Grammy Award performers in the city of Miramar? Who would have thought that just 10 years ago, right? And we have that here for our residents. Our Miramar Cultural Center. These are some of our upcoming events, and I'm really proud of the staff at our Cultural Center because they really did a pivot during the pandemic. Obviously, we had to shut down the Cultural Center, but they didn't just sit there and do nothing. We had so many creative ways to give cultural experiences to our community, even though it was virtual. But as restrictions lightened up, we really engaged families. Kids were coming into our cultural center who was no longer doing banquet orders because banquets were kind of shut down. But we brought kids in to the kitchen and taught them how to cook and had contests. So that was really cool. And I really give kudos to our Miramar cultural staff for really stepping outside. And that's just one example of our many departments that have really responded to the new way of life. One of our biggest assets in the city of Miramar is our over 40 parks, whether they're passive, active, throughout the city. And we are adapting to those offerings by providing opportunities. For example, we just opened our Dog Central. We have an upcoming skate park. All of our current parks are going through some form of renovation, whether if we're resurfacing our play courts, changing out play equipment, so they are providing shade structures for our families when they visit, because we want to make sure that recreation is a pleasant experience for our communities. And our Miramar Amphitheater has really put the city of Miramar on the map. We've had some really great opportunities to bring the community together for entertainment. And during the pandemic, Regina Park actually was a very important asset for the city to serve the community, and I'll share that in a moment. Now, the investment we've made in historic Miramar, over $160 million, and a lot of that was our stormwater management investments, streetscape improvements. I talked a moment about our East Water Treatment Plant. We're currently improving streetways around AC Perry to enhance the parent drop-off experience, and also looking at our canal embankment restoration throughout the city. This map illustrates the improvements that are taking place in historic Miramar. It's so massive. Most of the infrastructure in East Miramar dates back to the 50s, 60s, and 70s. We all know, and not to get into national politics, we know that there's something a little bit different in our climate. Rain events are more frequent, they're more intense, and at the end of the day, what it means to you is that when you come home or we wake up in the morning, you don't want to see your driveway flooded. And that has been the case in many neighborhoods, but we've responded. We've completed phase one, phase two, we just finished phase three, we are in engineering design for phase four, and we'll be kicking off five, six, and seven. But because of the cost, the capital cost to do this, we have to phase it out. But we are communicating with our community to let them know how much it costs, what neighborhoods will be fixed, when it will be fixed, and we celebrate when that zone is done. And I'd like to thank our Public Works Department, our Engineering Department, as well as our City Commission by passing a budget and a capital improvement plan to ensure that these investments are taking place. I talked about our East Water Treatment Plant. That's what it looked like before. Nearly $40 million project. And this is what it looks like right now. It is one of the most advanced, newest water treatment facilities in the nation, providing the purest and safest drinking water for our residents. So what does that mean to you other than it being safe? Because all that matters to you is when you wake up, you want to be able to brush your teeth and flush the toilet when you wake up, right? But what it means in historic Miramar If we are saying we will revitalize and redevelop East Miramar, you must have the infrastructure, the engineering to support the businesses and the developments that will come to the city. And that's what's important. It's not exciting, it's not sexy, but it is what must take place. And we're making that a priority. In addition, in historic Miramar, our historic Miramar Public Safety Complex, if investors are going to put assets in historic Miramar, they need to make sure that we have a safety presence to ensure that their investments are safe. In the city of Miramar, let's give a big round of applause to our Miramar Police Department and Fire Department for what they do every day to keep our community safe. Now let's take a brief moment to pause on the pandemic and what and how your city responded to the pandemic, because it really was and still continues to be a challenge for us. So how did we help as a city? Well, we'll look at how we help the residential community, our business partners, and our city staff. For our residents, do you know that we struggled initially with the state and the governor to get a testing site in historic Miramar? Because we knew we needed something like a walk-up site for residents who couldn't get all the way over to Hard Rock or all the way over to C.B. Smith Park. And we finally got it open, and we tested many individuals, our residents, who had a close-by testing facility. And we also were able to open up a vaccination site at Vizcaya Park that still remains open. And for those of you who qualify and are fully vaccinated, we encourage you to even get your booster shot. Miramar Regional Park. We talked about the regional park and how it was activated. Do you know that we served over 4.5 million pounds of food to the community right from Regional Park? Significant impact to our community, totaling almost $5 million. For our residents, nearly $1 million in rental assistance, mortgage assistance, and we put a moratorium on utility disconnections. So what does that mean to you? During the pandemic, you could live your life and ride this wave with the certainty that the most valuable resource like water would not be interrupted for your family and your home. Or maybe because you couldn't work, but you had rent or your mortgage due, that you wouldn't be evicted or foreclosed on. So the city was able to maximize and utilize the resources that we had. And in the city of Miramar, we didn't sit back and wait for the federal government. We knew at some point the federal government would respond, but we knew that our residents needed assistance now. So we took the risk and used our resources to go ahead and put out a lot of the resources and the support for our community with our fingers crossed, hoping that the federal government would act and we were able to be able to respond to this need and impact that the residents really relied upon. For our business community, our Economic and Business Development Department went out into the community. We issued personal protection equipment and resources for businesses as we began to reopen to ensure that their businesses were safe. We offered assistance for rental and utility payments for our businesses, as well as mortgage payments. As well as when you combine our way of payment in the city of Miramar, we waived all of the credit card processing fees that totaled nearly $1 million between residential and business transactions in the city of Miramar. The city of Miramar, we really took advantage to maximize a lot of the federal dollars. We were able to reimburse ourselves on the risk that we took to step and fill in the gap for our community. And we were able to pay ourselves back without the certainty of being paid back from the federal government. So that came through for us. We received $22 million from the American Rescue Plan Act that was planned. We received half of that money, and then later this year, we will receive the remainder of the $22 million to continue to provide those services to the community. And during the pandemic, the city of Miramar received two prestigious designations. First, we've been recognized by the Miramar All-America City as the All-America City, which is not an easy feat. And this theme for the year of 2021 is how communities responded to the pandemic. And because of the hard work of our city staff, with the idea initially coming from our commissioner, Commissioner Davis, to say we should apply for this because we're doing so many good things in the community, and we were recognized by the Civic League as an All-America City. So thank you to our community and to our hardworking staff for that. Our second recognition is the City of Miramar received two International Smart City Awards by the Smart 50 organization. We went to Washington, D.C. to collect this award. For those of you who have attended State of the Cities before, if you remember my initial State of the City address, I said that the City of Miramar, we needed to organize efforts to become a smart city, which means, so what does it mean to be a smart city? Well, in a nutshell, what it means is taking advantage of data and technology to better serve your communities in a more efficient way. And our city staff, under the leadership of our assistant city manager, and now our deputy manager, Kelvin Baker, formed a group called CARES. And one of the ideas, that group was using city staff, and they meet, I think, weekly or every other week, to come up with better ways to serve the community. And many ideas come out of those meetings. And they come up with ways, and we had two projects that surfaced out of this project. One was our smart water reading system and our building facility energy management system that saves money on energy consumption, and it automates our ability to shut off power sources in the community. And we received two awards. We were probably one of two cities internationally to receive not one, but two of our projects recognized. And great job to our city staff. And I would like to say a special thank you for the continuous service of our Miramar employees. You know, as the mayor and my colleagues on the commission, a lot of times we are the face of a lot of recognition in the community, but we could not do this without the hard work of every department that works for our city. And we want to thank our city staff for what you do every day as public servants. So we've had an opportunity to look at some of our successes. We took a pause on how the city responded to the pandemic. So as I conclude this State of the City address, where do we go from here as a city? What is our way forward in this new normal, which is still dynamic? The virus is still here. Inflation is rising. The supply chain is challenged. If you haven't started your Christmas shopping, I urge you to do that now, because you may order something and make sure that it gets here for Christmas, because there's so many ships on the West Coast that can't even unload because of the lack of drivers. So take advantage of that. But what is our new norm, and how do we move forward? Well, the question begs that with all this progress that we've enjoyed over the years and even during the pandemic to date, how do we continue to progress in a time of flux, in a time of uncertainty? Should I vax my 5-year-old child? Do I return to work or stay home? How do I find housing? How will I afford a place to live? Will a robot or some technology take my job? That's our new norm. So as a city, how do we empower our residents, our small businesses, our large businesses, and our economy to thrive in this new norm that is still being developed? And if I'm a business, where do I find a workforce? Workers who have the skills and the ability to do the work for me to be competitive. To progress in our new norm, there are a couple of things we have to do. First, we must keep our city safe in two areas. As it relates to us fighting this pandemic, we have to ensure that we have the ability to get our residents tested, as well as vaccinated for those who choose to be vaccinated. And for those who have not gotten to the point of comfort to be vaccinated, what resources we can provide to those individuals to ensure that they remain safe. That's a challenge we have to continue to do. Second, we always have to fight crime. If you are a city that is infested with uncontrollable crime, it stops the importation of businesses, of families. No one wants to invest in you. You've seen the economic activity that's taking place, all of the development. There is no way in the world they would come to Miramar if they felt that we did not have a competent police department and a safe community. So we have to continue to give the resources to our police department to ensure that we are taking advantage of technology to keep our community safe. And we have already begun to invest in those resources to ensure that we do that. Second, we need to keep Miramar relevant. We can't rest on our laurels. Some of you may know I used to play football. All-American in high school, played at Florida State University. Yeah, we play University of Miami on Saturday. You know, we may not win that game. We're not good that good this year. But guess what? I brought up Miami for a specific reason. When I played at Florida State, we were national champions, but also the University of Miami. Outside of the University of Florida, one of our biggest rivals, mutual respect there. Both of us hate the Gators, but a mutual respect between Florida State and the University of Miami. So what does football have to do with this presentation? Well, I learned a valuable lesson from a speech by one of our arch rivals, Jimmy Johnson, who was a very successful coach at the University of Miami. He had a speech to his team that said, and one of his quotes was that you either get better or you get worse. There's no such thing in staying the same. Miramar, we cannot rest on our laurels. We've been blessed with a lot of success, but we can't rest on our laurels. We're either going to get better or worse. And the way we get better is by staying relevant, by implementing smart city solutions, by getting those public-private partnerships, by investing in our residents, investing in our small businesses, ensuring that it is easy to do business with us, with the community in mind, as we continue to progress. We must remain a corporate leader. You hear me say all the time that the city of Miramar, that we have more Fortune 500 companies than any city in South Florida. But when you dig deeper, when I say more Fortune 500 companies than any city in South Florida, that means they either have a headquarters here, a regional presence, or some presence in the city of Miramar. No other city can boast that but Miramar. But we can't rest on that, because many of those corporations may not exist in 10 years. There will be disruptors that will enter the marketplace. Amazon just 15 years ago was an online bookstore. And look at them now. Who will be the next Amazon? And how does Miramar be attractive for that next Miramar to call Miramar home? That is how we need to be thinking. You're talking about electric vehicles coming in. Most manufacturers are getting rid of combustion engines. And they have a large array of products in electrical vehicles in development. How will our streets accommodate that? What will be our EV charging infrastructure to support that type of growth? That is how we need to be thinking for us to remain relevant. And finally, we need to invest in our technology and infrastructure, as I just mentioned. Our transportation network, our workforce in affordable housing. You know, I'm so glad to see some children here this evening. We have our Boy Scouts here this evening. They're our future leaders of our community. How are we educating them? How are we giving them the tools to be relevant? I'll pause for a minute and recognize that he doesn't know I'm going to do this. Joshua, stand up, Joshua. Joshua, just 5 or 6 years ago, budding student, I don't have a spotlight to put on him, budding student, wasn't certain on where his life or what he wanted to do in his life, started attending aviation academies that my office would put forward, and he took a liking to it. And aviation is a big sector in our city. And now he decided, he got interested, he attended the Broward College Air Traffic Control Program that's located right behind City Hall that a lot of people don't know about. But because we're reaching out into the community, individuals and young men, you can have a seat, Joshua, are taking advantage of those opportunities. And now Joshua is employed in the aviation sector. So that is where the rubber hits the road. Reaching out to our youth, ensuring that they have the resources, not just for today, but for tomorrow. We have some bright minds that will be producers and innovators. We have all these Fortune 500 companies. We had a workshop yesterday with Siemens, and we were talking about smart city concepts. And I challenged them about their investment into the community. And guess what? Siemens is a global company. They have an office here in Miramar. But they invest millions of dollars in startups. They invest millions of dollars in, they have an in-house venture capital organization that are looking for young, bright minds like these two beautiful young girls here, that if we get them involved in STEM opportunities, that they can be invested in with their companies, not to work for Siemens, but to solve the problems of tomorrow. That is the conversation we need to be having as a city. If we're not investing the resources and getting this collaboration done now, how can we be relevant moving forward? How can we direct resources where they need to go? It's not about the now, but it's about where we will be 10, 15, 20 years from now. I don't study these scripts. Yes, we have slides. I don't have a script, but this is a conversation. I want to challenge us. I want to challenge my colleagues on the commission. I want to challenge our city administration. I want to challenge you as the residents, our city employees. Demand from us that we bring these conversations forward. Because if we're not relevant, we won't remain number one. We won't remain on the top. There's no such thing of staying the same. We must be better, or we will be worse. So let's hear from our community. Let's hear from members of the community who are telling us what they are looking for in our city. They'll share some things about what they like about the city of Miramar, but they'll also give some pointers in terms of some things that we can do better. Let's take a look.
My name is Marcia Akins, and I've been a resident of this beautiful city of Miramar for 45 years.
I'm Joan McLean, and I'm a resident of Miramar for approximately 30 years.
The future of Miramar looks very promising. We have been keeping up with all the cities.
So far, it's booming because we have a lot of different construction going on.
And the potential is awesome.
As it relates to safety in Miramar, we have a lot more police officers. I have personally seen them in my neighborhood.
The city is on top of everything with COVID. We have vaccination stations all around. We have testing.
There's a lot of centers open now where you can freely walk without any congestion to go get your vaccine done.
I feel safe.
the city can stay relevant by modeling other cities.
I think we have had good prospects in keeping up to date, but there's still a few works that has to be done, like on the thoroughfare, like Miramar Parkway. There are certain areas that needs improving.
Improving the quality of life for me in Miramar would be releasing more information. For example, the commission meeting. People on the east side is not even aware of it, and I would recommend that they put these monitors that give flashpoints of what is happening.
Taking control of the traffic situation, taking control of the vast majority of business to make sure that they operate and keep in a safer environment. I'm here 45 years, and if I'm here that long, that means that I'm here to stay.
Who better to hear from someone who has invested 45 years of their life here in the city of Miramar, which means that they didn't move here when they were 3 years old. All right, they were an adult when they moved and chose Miramar. 45 years ago is not the Miramar that we know today. And when you think about 45 years, wow, I was only 2 years old when she moved here. But we can learn a lot from our residents when we talk to them and ask them what they are expecting from our community. My final presentation this evening is I want you to imagine Miramar. Imagine what we can be. Imagine what we can do. Over the last few State of the City addresses, we showed what the State Road 7 corridor could look like. Right now, we're in the heart of what is called the AWD District, which is Arts, Workforce, and Entertainment, which includes our Anson Sports Complex, where we've had Olympic competitions taking place, our Miramar Cultural Center, and the Miramar Park of Commerce, which is our AWD District. We've recently done a land use development amendment to downtown historic Miramar, which will bring affordable housing and prospectively Innovation Village and other components to really energize and redevelop downtown historic Miramar. So I want to bring all these components together. Now, what you will see is just an illustration, a possibility. We still have to make these decisions, but it will give some thought of what we can be with your input, working together with the City Commission and our city administration on what we can do and be as a city. So we'll bring together all of these elements of the regions of the community and just think about what we can become. Let's show the video. Obviously, these are all concepts and visuals, but it's just to get the imagination juices flowing, right? But to grow, we must do this intentionally, because we don't want to grow and leave our community behind. We don't want to leave our residents who have invested 20 years, 25 years, 30 years, 40 years behind, like so many other communities that have redeveloped and have expanded and have gentrified communities. We must find a way, and we can find a way. We can be the model, a national model, on advancing, not in just providing affordable housing like you're seeing on the screen right now, which was just passed the other day. But we can work with the public sector and the private sector in getting partnerships to invest in our youth, to invest in our current residents. We have an agreement with Broward College and a Broward Up program to advance skills for what are needed today. And working with some of our corporate partners in higher education to ensure that the skills for tomorrow are integrated. And taking it to another level by challenging young entrepreneurs and challenging thought leaders, inventors, entrepreneurs to solve the challenges of today. Most of venture capital is in the Silicon Valley. There's a certain percentage in the Northeast. One of the stigmas of South Florida as it relates to IT and STEM is that we don't have the talent. That is bogus. There are so many programmers. There are so many innovators here. We need to be bringing that venture capital here in the city of Miramar, and we can do that. No other city is talking about how do we take advantage of the Northeast migration to South Florida, which is a big catalyst in why real estate values are going up so high, because everyone is moving to South Florida. But if we invest in the skills now in our community, not only will we prepare our students to be trained and skilled and more competitive workforce, but we can train our youth, our current residents, to be the innovators and the problem solvers of today. You saw the video with HCW. They say they joke around and say heaven can't wait. Can you imagine that in the city of Miramar, we have a biotech company that is not even looking to cure your pain or to beat cancer. They are researching to help you live longer. We think this might be some sci-fi movie, but we are on the cusp of providing therapeutic treatment that will extend your life. And they're already here in Miramar. We must capitalize on that. We must embrace that. We must expose our children to that. Because when our children are exposed to the possibilities, their minds work much better than ours. So we will make sure that we will intentionally have these conversations. So Miramar, just imagine, if we work together, if we elevate these conversations and channel these conversations to solutions, that the city of Miramar will not only keep our city safe in a time of flux, will not only remain relevant in a time of flux, will not only have the technology and the infrastructure in the time of flux, but we will thrive and emerge number one despite the flux. Miramar, thank you for coming out this evening, and I hope you've enjoyed the State of the City address. Have a good evening.